wildcrafted. This word gets thrown around a lot, and many believe this is the only way to go. But what are the pros and cons of wildcrafting, especially when it comes to seaweeds like sea moss? Is there a dark side to this practice? Well, find all of that out, along with other key things to consider when purchasing seaweeds, all on this video. If you're ready, let's go. It's the hot boy. Wildcrafting is the process of gathering herbs, plants, and fungi in the wild. In the wild, things grow organically, and that is without human intervention. It follows the natural life cycle of a plant. But the point is, in the wild, all of this happens without human intervention. So wild crops can be limited in supply, and supply cannot be easily increased. So for example, one of the reasons why Panax ginseng is so expensive is because it's a wild herb. It takes about 4 years to mature, and since there's more demand than supply, price goes up because this herb is a lot more rarer. Fun fact, 4 states and 5 national forests in America actively manage the wild harvesting of ginseng along with other crops to ensure the sustainability of wild populations. Well, the difference between land herbs and seaweeds are part of a much larger ecosystem, and seaweeds in the oceans tend to have a purpose. A quick backstory to this video is, last year I traveled to Asia, and whilst out there I got the opportunity to snorkel. And before snorkeling, we were told to not touch any rocks, as they are populated by reefs and seaweeds, and if we damage them, we can have an impact on the whole ecosystem of that particular part of the ocean. Now, that got me thinking, if one person touching a rock can have an effect, what impact is the boost in demand for seaweeds like sea moss having on our oceans? These line of questioning set out the foundation for this video. On this video, I'm going to lay out my research. Some of you guys will agree, some of you guys won't agree, but just comment your thoughts below. Let's get the conversation going, let's get the dialogue going, and that's how we all grow. As I say all the time, we are a community and we help each other. So firstly, before I get into the pros and cons of wildcrafting, let's discuss how important sea vegetables are in the oceans. Seaweed is food for many sea animals. These sea animals can get eaten by other sea animals. Thus, seaweeds are important in the food chain. But seaweeds also provide shelter for many forms of sea life, and this could be also to hide from potential predators. It's said that this ecosystem is very, very finely balanced, and if key species disappear, the entire ecosystem can drastically change.
But with most of the heat from global warming going into our oceans, much of this seaweed has been wiped out, including 95% of kelp along the east coast of Tasmania.
In the Caribbean and other countries where seaweeds were traditionally eaten, it was traditionally eaten when it washes ashore. And the reasons why seaweed washes ashore is because it has been broken, died, or lost contact with its holding surface. And this is because a seaweed grows a holdfast that cements into the rocks or into the soil. So if this holdfast breaks, it floats up and it can wash ashore. And this tended to be what the locals consumed. And even if it was foraged or wildcrafted, this doesn't really have an effect on the ecosystem of the ocean. But sea moss and other seaweeds have exploded in popularity, and this global demand has risen. Did you know that the global seaweed market is projected to be worth $24 billion by 2024? So the question is, can this boost in demand for wildcrafted seaweed be negative or have an effect on our oceans that we love so much? What are the real pros and cons of wildcrafted, and is there another option that we could potentially consider? So before we get into the cons, let's talk about the pros or benefits of wildcrafted seaweeds like sea moss. So the first benefit of wildcrafted is that we are taking the seaweed directly from nature without any human interaction. This might mean that its nutrients are whole, they're pure. Well, this is the thought process anyway. The second benefit of wildcrafting, especially with things like sea moss, is that we know we are getting the potential best that nature has to offer. And the third benefit of wildcrafting is that it supposedly yields the most nutritional value per pound. It's very nutritionally dense if it comes directly from its original source. But with nature, history shows us that there's always a cost, especially for when demand goes up. For example, when the West learned about quinoa, popularity exploded. exploded. But the cost here is that the cost of quinoa also went so high that those who have eaten quinoa for generations were no longer able to afford it. The locals got priced out of something that they hold dear to their culture. So, can there be a cost of wildcraft and sea moss? Well, before I speak about this a bit more, the point here is not to bash anybody. It's just to give people the whole picture. When you have the whole picture, you can see clearly and make up your mind of what best to do next. And as always, guys, all my research links are in the description if you want to learn a bit more. So, the cons. I've kind of alluded to this already. We know that wild crafted sea moss is collected from the shorelines or beaches in areas where sea moss grows naturally. The process typically involves cutting or removing sea moss from the location where it has embedded itself. So, the first con is the potential disruption of the natural ecosystem, as we know how important sea moss is for the food chain and how important it is for the organisms in the water. The second con of wildcrafting is the potential sustainability issues. How much can we really take from the ocean without replanting or reinstating? Yes, there are ways to ensure sustainability in the ecosystem, such as not actually uprooting the sea moss, but just cutting it. But how many farmers are practicing this? So this might be an issue, especially for those who care about sustainability in our planet. How do you go around choosing what sea moss is best for you? And how do you go around choosing companies that are practicing good social responsibility? This is something really important to consider. The last con of wildcrafting is that the environment consistently changes. For example, as one colony is uprooted or harvested and we get the sea moss from it, the forager then has to move on to another. So, how transparent can a company be about the conditions and environment in which the new seaweed is grown in? How can that be extrapolated or even said, hey, it has this much nutrients in it now? Does that mean they have to consistently keep testing the new waters as their environments change from crop to crop? Something else to consider. But with that being said, where do we go from here? Well, I was under the impression that things are kind of black and white when it comes to seaweeds. We have pool grown and then there's wild crafted, but there's actually a third option. And this third option is often marketed as wild crafted anyway. And these are farmed in open waters. So it's kind of a farm in the open waters in the ocean. So this third option has been dubbed ocean farmed. This is where it grows on ropes or on rocks in the ocean, but there's human intervention here. It's said that this is more sustainable. So with that being said, should you make a change or should you continue as is? Well, the choice is yours, but I do feel it's our responsibility to ensure the supplies of our sea moss are ethical and stand for sustainability. Whether this is sustainable wildcrafting measures or that the seaweed and harvesting measures and growing measures are sustainable, whether they're replanting or trimming without uprooting. This is very important. Like, did you know that seaweeds oxygenate the water? Similarly to how plants and trees oxygenate the air on land. This also helps with the pH in waters. So companies that help with replacing what they take, or even basic things as their cutting techniques, these are who we should be giving our money to, as there are others and many others, especially when there's money involved, that are cutting corners. So this video is something different. There's no real conclusion to it. It's just be mindful that this boost in demand could potentially have an impact on our oceans, and thus that has an impact on us. So be wiser, and I wanted to show you guys an other side of the coin, as I see nobody really talking about the negative side of wildcrafting and things like that. Okay guys, so let me know your thoughts in the comments, guys. And before you go, if you want to learn more about herbs, click on my face and get my herb guide. And before you go, check out these two videos right here and right here. Guys, I'll see you guys on the next one. Peace.